Well, good morning. Welcome to summer in the Okanagan. Isn't it great? Oh, I got mosquito bites all over me from camping up north, I'll tell you. And it feels good. Even that feels good. I just am so grateful for where I live and what it looks like out there and how wonderful it is. And it just constantly and consistently fills me with awe. And the fact that I'm turn around and leave here shortly is very disappointing. I've got to tell you, though, I discovered in this last trip just incredibly how addicted I am to the work that I do and what happens with it. And maybe you can relate to it, I don't know. But do you realize that there is no Rogers telephone service as soon as you leave Barrier, British Columbia? Have you got any idea? And after all those years of working that phone, I've been neglecting going out into the woods. So we took our grandchildren up to Barkerville to see my son. He's one of the, I guess they're called docents, but the actors in Barkerville, my son and son-in-law. And so we took the family, we went up to Barkerville and camped up in Barkerville, home of the flies. And as we drove up there, as soon as we left Barrier, headed up to stay in the Caribou, all of a sudden our phones just went dead. There was nothing there. And this has nothing to do with today's talk, aside from the fact that I've got to tell you how uncomfortable it was to go all those days without a telephone and not to have the communication. And when I think about it, I've only had a phone for 8 years. Before that, I wouldn't even think about it. Only had a computer for 15. So, well, amazing how life changes and how addicted I am to what I do and how I do it, and to the communication and the ability to be able to stick with people. Today's title Consciousness Never Takes a Vacation. And really, the purpose that I want to get across to you is something that we already know, that we believe in this teaching deeply, and that is that we create our own experiences no matter what. And no matter where I go, my consciousness shows up. I can't put it off to the side, and I can't forget it. It's going to create the form of my experience no matter what, no matter where, no matter what's happening, whether I've got cell service or not. It's going to continue to create according to how I deal with it. But in order to be able to really get into this talk, I first want to talk about and I want to define for you what I believe consciousness to be. Of course, there's large C consciousness, which is the consciousness of spirit, of life, of the divinity itself, which sits out there, which moves and flows in perfection. Like water always finding level, that consciousness always finds peace, it always finds balance, it always finds neutrality, it always finds joy, it always finds expansion, it always develops and evolves and builds to the highest and the greatest, and we can count and we can really, really trust that this is going to happen and this is going to occur in our life. And what we learn is the other side of the consciousness, which is the small C consciousness, which is our consciousness. It's the consciousness that we hold to be true. And all of us have, in some level or way, a consciousness that represents and puts itself out into the world around us. And it does so unerringly. It never misses a beat. It never creates something which is a cosmic mistake. What it does is it creates according to our belief system and brings it into being. Now, a lot of us, and I perhaps on this particular talk, I should talk solely about myself rather than anyone else, because I'm sure some of you do not have these issues that I do. But the issues that I have is sometimes I forget that I've got this consciousness, and I allow the belief systems that I've held in the past, the things that I know to be true, the things that I inherently use as a foundation of life, the things that have come from time immemorial, way, way back, they have a tendency to come forward in my life and to have the expression and the experience and to create a form. And if I allow them to control me, then I cannot experience what we just sang about, which is the peace, the joy, the grace, and the love. Because the natural large C consciousness is for those things to come forward. And in most cases, what I want in my life is I want more joy. I want more peace. I want more harmony and grace, and I want more love. And I want my life to be able to flow in that and be that. And what prevents it from happening is not a bad thing in my consciousness, or for anyone out there who might have the same idea in the consciousness, it's not a bad thing for you. But what it is the ability to be able to utilize and use it according to the law to be able to emulate the consciousness of life itself. Not to personalize, not to itemize, not to limit what's there, but to allow that to be the natural resource and recourse for the way that I think. So consciousness for me is the sum total of my belief. Now, right off the bat, what I think about consciously is not my consciousness. It's part of my consciousness, a very small part of my consciousness. The reality is that humanity has a consciousness which expands deeper. It is not just your conscious ability to think, it is your unconscious ability to think as well. That's the way that it works, and it has a tendency to show up. And that which we have built our foundation on, which is the consciousness of our history, has always been there and always will be there. And we are not about trying to get rid of it. What we're about is utilizing the consciousness that works for us, as opposed to trying to go just by rote with the consciousness that always comes forward. Am I making sense? Yes, two or three of you. Good. So I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. I, to the best of my ability, and for decades and decades, I have attempted to live my life in joy, in grace, in peace, in harmony, in abundance, in love, in light, in beauty. That's the life that I want to live. Unfortunately, not always does it come forward. And what usually blocks or stops it is my own urge that comes from below in an area of my consciousness that I'm not even awake or aware of. And what happens is it forces itself into my circumstance. And when I react to it as opposed to utilize and direct it, what happens is the end result of my experience is that it overpowers me. I'll give you an example of the type of consciousness that I'm talking about. You know that we all have a consciousness of survival. That there is that within us that prevents us from doing things that in any way would allow ourselves to be harmed to the best of our ability. And anything beyond that would be an anomaly. So I always remember years ago wanting to live in harmony, wanting to live in love, wanting to live in grace, wanting to live in the beauty of life, and pursuing that to the very best of my ability. And I met this beautiful young woman by the name of Deborah Komerniski at the time, not Gordon. And I can remember being connected to her, and I can remember my whole life would be devoted to her. This was that feeling and that sense of love. Do you know what I'm talking about? I certainly hope so. There's that part of me that just, oh, I adored this woman. And there was nothing that I wouldn't do to make her happy, or almost nothing that I wouldn't do to make her happy. And believe me, she utilized it 100% and manipulated me to the very best of her ability. She was very coy and very good at what she did. And I would go along with it because that's all I wanted was to be with her. That's it. This is it. This is sweetheart, no doubt about it. So what happened was, we were living in Vancouver in Kitsilano at the time, and this must have been a long time ago. I won't tell you because she's part of it. So the end result is we were living in Kitsilano, and we were having a wonderful time. Deborah was in university. I can't remember what I was doing. And I remember that we'd go out and we'd go jogging. And so I remember we were jogging down 6th Avenue in Kitsilano, and we were trundling along, having a great time, just out puffing and panting. And we ran past this house, and there was a front yard in the house, and in the front yard was this humongous dog, a real big, vicious dog. And we're jogging along, and this dog came out and started to attack us. All I want in life is the joy, the harmony, the grace, the beauty. That's all I want. And that part came up inside of me of survival. And what I did was I grabbed Deborah and threw her into the dog and ran on. True story. I put her between me and the dog. They were running along. Dog jumps, grab Deborah, put Deborah there. Okay? I know I'm the only one with that consciousness. It came instantaneously from the very bowels of my being. It was not a conscious act. It was an act of survival. And I had learned years ago, somehow or other, that if I put something between me and it, then I'm going to be okay. It's like the old story. You don't have to run faster than the bear. You only have to run faster than the person you're with. So I put it right there. And when I realized it, when it dawned on me consciously what I'd done, I corrected, of course. I mean, I can't remember exactly how I did it. Go away, dog. Go away. Don't attack her. I don't know exactly how it happened, but I know that I corrected. And I know that I thought, oh, God, what a jerk I am. I just threw her in front of the dog. And I won't tell you what she thought. Because I don't know, but I know how she acted, which was that coyness just went away. And so there I was with that circumstance. So that's an idea or an example of what happens to us. Now, you know that consciously I would never do that, or at least I trust you know that consciously I would never do that. And I would never do that. That would not be something that I would choose to do in my life. And yet, there it was. And so what I've learned, or what I learned through science of mind, through the things that we do and the way that we live our lives and the choices that we make, is that I will never get rid of that. Neither will you. That need to protect ourselves comes instantaneously. And our objective is to make it into something that is effective in our experience rather than ineffective. Trust me, throwing your wife in front of the dog is not an effective thing to do for your relationship. So you've got, what I learned is that I have to learn to be able to control that, not to say that it's bad and not to get rid of it. It's not for me to get rid of. It's part of my inherent reptilian consciousness. It's that which exists at the very base of who I am. We believe in evolution. We know that we've all evolved and come from somewhere. And I would wager that every one of us in some way or another has done something similar or something that could be used as an example the same way. And we didn't do it with a conscious awareness. We did it because that's part of who we are and part of that consciousness that never takes a vacation. It doesn't go away. What we do is we learn to manipulate it and utilize it through discipline to be able to take us to where we want to go. I will tell you is that I am a prime advocate of classes, whether I'm teaching them or taking them. And the reason is because it makes me aware of the power that I have and the ability that I have to be able to redirect those impulses and those thoughts that are there. You know, oftentimes, even in classes or things that we do, what happens is I fall away from it. I fall back from my own good and back from my own knowledge, back from my own knowing into an area of my life that somehow or other is reactive according to the default button that I go to when I'm frightened, when fear enters into my life. And I know that it happens. I've seen it happen with other people. I've seen perfectly wonderful human beings who live an absolute balanced life, who are threatened or injured or hurt by someone who says something or does something. And what happens is they fall into that default. And you know what I'm talking about? You suddenly become defensive. You become angry at someone. You want to be right about it. Just like Reverend Melody talking about forgiveness, you don't untie yourself from it, you tie yourself to it. And what you do is you join right in and you do everything in your power to limit the amount of grace, the amount of joy, the amount of love, and the amount of peace that you might have in your experience. And you do it for a good, just reason that you can justify to anybody who's around you by telling them what a doofus this person was or how they hurt you or whatever goes on with it. But in reality, the only person who's really suffering and really hurting is you. And so what we learn to do is we learn to be able to guide and direct that. And it works impeccably. Deborah and I, for years, have taught Science of Mind in the summer, in the all year long, from September through till June. And I know that we would look forward to being able to be off Science of Mind classes, because it meant two or three extra nights a week that we got to stay home and we got to relax. It was like a holiday. And so we would be in the backyard having a great time, enjoying ourselves. We would still be doing Sunday services. We would still be doing our daily practices. But what we would do is we would just stop and step back from the teaching of it. And what would occur inevitably is we would begin to move to the default. We would begin to move to the default whenever we weren't aware, conscious, or awake of the truth of our being. And when that would occur, what would happen is our life, which would be going in a beautiful upward slope as far as the evolution would go, would suddenly flatten off and then begin to tilt a little bit. And it happened when we used to take holidays when we were students, too. We would pack up the car and we would come to Canada and we would go on a holiday for a month up here. And that month that we were up here, immediately what we'd do is find default. We'd go back to the default of our being, back to that reptilian urge of our consciousness. Because what would happen is we would be separated and divorced from the awareness and the knowledge that we get to utilize it. That's okay. This is a teaching, a healing teaching ministry. And the teaching is the most awesome aspect of it. When you go into classes and you participate in classes, you have all of these people who are there who are supporting you on reminding you that you get to control those urges and those impulses. That they do not control you, but you get to direct them. You don't get to direct them by saying they're bad. You accept them. And then what you do is you utilize them and use them to work into your life, to create a greater sense of abundance, to create a greater sense of loving relationship, to create a deeper sense of creative expression, and to create a greater health consciousness within your own being and your body. And that is exactly what we're talking about. You know, just this last week, when we were up in Barkerville, I built a fire. I'm very proud of my fire building expression. But I was building a fire in this campsite, and, you know, it just didn't quite light. It kind of became less of a fire and more of a smolder. And we were surrounded by these neighbors, and we had this thing going out that was just smoking like crazy and smoking out all our neighbors. And everybody had fires, so it's okay, we could build one too. And this guy comes over from the trailer next to our campsite, and he says, what are you doing there? You building a smolder or you building some smoke? It's awful smoky over here. Why don't you put that damn thing out? Guess where I went? I went immediately to that part of my consciousness which I would share as the bottom part or the bottom 90%. I fell immediately to, who the hell do you think you are to come tell me to put out my damn fire? Yeah, you know, I mean, I became defensive because of a statement that was made. And it wasn't that I reacted on it, because believe me, I'm far too advanced to do that. But every cell in my body wanted to say something that was not nice. Every cell in my body wanted to tell him to go mind his own damn business, but I didn't. Instead, what I did was I smiled and said, yes, it is more like a smolder, and I kept working on it until eventually I got the fire to go. But that's the reaction that we have. And the ability is to be able to control it. Because I will tell you something, if I had responded, we would have had a very uncomfortable evening with our neighbors. Plus, I know enough about consciousness, the fire would never have lit. It would have smoldered all night. I could have poured water on it and peed on it, and it still would smolder. You know what I'm talking about. It would just work and react the way that it does. And that's what happens in so many areas of our life. You know, we want to make more money. We want to have more money in our life. And yet we react to everything that has to do about money. And we react from the bottom 90% of our consciousness, not the awareness. We react from the bottom. And we don't have to. And the answer, the solution, is to operate from the top, to operate from the peace, the grace, the love, the beauty, the joy. When we operate from that, what happens to us is we draw and attract into our experience the support we need in order to live there. But when we react from our default, when we react from that God gift of evolution, that inherent genetic idea that we have as a society and as individuals, what happens is we get blowback. We suddenly start finding ourselves in circumstances that are less than comfortable. And we create it for ourselves by the way that we react to it in the first place. You know, we don't get our own way. Somebody doesn't give us into a position we want. Somebody says something or we feel something is happening that is anti what we want to have happen. We get hurt. And when we get hurt, we don't go to our spiritual truth and live in the quadrants that we know will manifest and bring into our being and our experience the life that we want to have. Instead, what we do is we allow ourselves to go to the default and we get to suffer more. How much more? Depends on how long you want to be in that position. Eventually we wake up and say, this doesn't work anymore. I don't care if they owe me money. This doesn't work anymore. I don't care if they don't recognize me. And when we get to that place, which I call the to hell with it consciousness, what happens is we begin to buoy back up again. And we begin to live in the principles that we're talking about. Because our consciousness never goes away. Our consciousness never leaves us. It's always there. It's always manifesting. It's always showing up. I know that this is the truth for me. I know that there's nothing wrong with that consciousness, that it serves its purpose. It saves me from rabid dogs at the cost of other things. But it still saves me from rabid dogs. But the truth is, that's not the life that I want to live. That's not the life I choose. And I can draw upon it when I need to. I can get it out of there when I need it. And I can utilize it when I need it. But I do not need it in this society on a day-to-day basis. And I don't need it if somebody's not nice to me. And I don't need it to be able to run my life in an effective manner like I want to do. So instead, what I do is I realize that I'm the one who's in charge of my thoughts. I'm the one who's in charge of how I allow my emotions to run or not. We had a beautiful example with Reverend Melody talking about how to forgive. You consciously affirm. You keep developing and building. You don't go away on holidays from your consciousness. You don't give up on the discipline that it takes. People have a mistaken idea about this teaching. A lot of them say it's a feel-good teaching. I will tell you, this is the hardest teaching in the world. It's a teaching that demands you take responsibility for your own thinking and your own thoughts. That you no longer give it away to somebody else. To say, oh, it's her fault. So that I get to blame her, so I get to feel good for a short period of time because I think I'm right. But in reality, suffer the rest of my life because I want to hold somebody else responsible for it. This is a teaching that demands that you be attentive to what you think and how you do it. It does not allow you the luxury of that negative thought. What it does is it calls upon you to bring forward everything in your being in order to live that life of joy. And I will tell you something, when you live that life of joy, when you live in that peace, when you live in that grace, when you live in that joy, and when you live in that beauty and that love, what will happen is those around you will as well. Not always. Not every day. But more than they do right now. And isn't that what you want? Don't you want a greater sense of joy in your being? Don't you want a greater sense of love? A greater sense of peace? Of course you do. We all want the same thing. And to do it, what we have to do is we have to surrender that reptilian idea that we hold behind us that means we have to defend every single thing. We need to recognize the difference between somebody who slights us and who we are and how we take that. We have to be brave enough and strong enough and acknowledge enough our own being and our own goodness to know that we no longer have to do that. There are other ways to handle it. And in the meantime, if the dog jumps out to attack, throw something between you and it. Hopefully not me or my wife. I love you and I bless you. Have a happy holiday.